Well, thanks very much, Terry, and thanks, Heidi. I've always wanted to speak at the Naval War College, so this is a great opportunity for me, and you've arranged great weather, too, so I can't complain. Well, as Terry described, I've spent most of my career in the U.S. government working on what we call the hard proliferation cases, Pakistan, India, Iraq, North Korea, Iran. And in particular, over the last 20 years, I've spent more time than is probably healthy working on North Korea and Iran. So I'd like to focus my remarks on looking at those two cases, similarities and differences. And it's important because those are probably the two countries that we focus most on in the nuclear nonproliferation business. Now, in many ways, North Korea and Iran are quite similar. In both cases, they began their nuclear weapons programs many years ago in the 1980s. In both cases, their nuclear weapons programs pose a direct threat to U.S. allies in the region, Japan and Korea in the case of North Korea, and Israel and Saudi and others in the case of Iran. And ultimately, their programs pose a direct threat to the United States as these countries seek to develop a long-range missile delivery capability along with nuclear weapons. Furthermore, in both of these cases, the nuclear issue is bound up in a broader hostile relationship that the U.S. has with both countries, which means that to some extent their motivation for developing nuclear weapons is caused in part by their perceived security threat from the United States, and the nuclear issue from the U.S. standpoint is part of a broader range of potential conflicts, including potential conventional conflict, as well as disagreement over political issues. And finally, the nuclear programs in Iran and North Korea represent the greatest threat now of further proliferation, the risk that the North Korean program could drive Japan or Korea to reconsider whether they need to have a nuclear deterrent, and in the case of the Middle East, the danger that Iran's program could drive other countries in the region, like Saudi or Turkey or Egypt, to pursue nuclear weapons. So there are lots of similarities, but there are also, I think, some very significant differences in terms of the motivations, the capabilities, the political systems, and the international circumstances of these two countries. And that has really affected the tools that we have available to deal with their nuclear programs, and I think that helps to explain the difference in our success or lack thereof. So let me go over some of the key differences between North Korea and Iran. First, in terms of motivation, I've always thought that the North Koreans view nuclear weapons as an existential requirement for survival. They see themselves as a very small, weak country surrounded by much more powerful enemies that want to destroy them. U.S., Japan, they don't trust the Chinese, the Koreans pose a big threat because they're so much more successful. And I think that the North Korean leadership thinks it needs to have nuclear weapons in order to fend off its enemies. I think Iran's motivations are much more complex and ambivalent. Certainly some Iranian leaders, I think the supreme leader, believes that Iran needs nuclear weapons for defensive purposes against enemies like the United States, and also sees nuclear weapons as an important instrument of national prestige and status to dominate other countries in the region. But other Iranians see the risk of acquiring nuclear weapons in terms of creating instability in the region and also antagonizing Iran's neighbors. So in other words, Iran, it seems to me, North Korea's motives are very pure and simple. They must have nuclear weapons to survive. While Iran, I think, sees nuclear weapons more as a desirable instrument of power rather than an absolute necessity. And they can afford, therefore, they can afford to take their time and weigh the acquisition of nuclear weapons against other considerations. So the Iranians really haven't pursued the same kind of crash nuclear weapons program that I think the North Koreans did. Now, these differences in motivation, I mean the perceived use of nuclear weapons also interacts with some very significant differences in the two political systems. In North Korea, which is a very peculiar state, it's the only communist one-party dynasty in history. As you all know, political power is very highly concentrated in the leadership and the military and security sectors. And obviously, public opinion is not an important constraint on what the government does. So as a result, North Korean leaders, starting with Kim Il-sung, and then his son, Kim Jong-il, and now his son, Kim Jong-un, have been very efficient in mobilizing people and resources for their nuclear weapons program. This has been a high priority for the government, and they've made sure that it has money and people and resources in order to achieve the objective. In contrast to North Korea, Iran's political system is relatively fragmented. Power is diffused among many competing factions within the leadership, the famous hardliners versus moderates. There's a relatively independent legislative and judicial branch of government, and there's a private business sector. Now, although the supreme leader, Khamenei, may have the final word, he has to balance these various factions and institutions, and he has to pay more attention to public opinion. And the result is that Iran's nuclear program has often been a bit under-resourced and relatively disorganized and inefficient, certainly in the early years of the program. They could have made more progress if they had put more resources toward their nuclear program. Now, these differences in motivation and government structure are also magnified by differences in basic capability. Although North Korea is obviously a very poor country, it emerged from World War II with a relatively well-developed heavy industrial base, because the Japanese, when they occupied Korea, they located most of the heavy industry in the north. While Iran emerged from World War II as basically an undeveloped third world country with virtually no heavy industry. So as a result, North Korea's had a much more independent capacity to develop an indigenous nuclear program, while Iran has been relatively more dependent on access to foreign expertise and assistance, as well as equipment and materials. So think of this. North Korea built its first plutonium production reactor and the facilities to produce fuel and separate plutonium more than 25 years ago, while Iran is still working to complete its first indigenous research reactor. So all of these differences in motivation and capability have influenced the tools that we have available. And I'm going to just talk about some of the differences in terms of instruments that the U.S. can use to deal with the threat. First, intelligence. As I'm sure you all know, our ability to collect intelligence against North Korea has always been very limited. And even now, we have huge gaps in understanding some of the most basic elements of North Korea's nuclear program, including the extent of its secret enrichment program and what its capabilities are to weaponize in terms of missile delivery. In contrast, we've been relatively successful in penetrating Iran's nuclear program over the years, including, for example, exposing their secret nuclear plants at Natanz and at Fordow while they were still in very early stages of construction, and gaining tremendous insight into their weaponization program before 2003. And those differences, as I said, reflect differences in the nature of the society and the political system. The North Koreans, much more difficult target because they have a much more effective counterintelligence program and much more brutal in terms of finding and killing spies than the Iranians ever were. A second big area of difference is export controls. Because the North Korean program, as I said, has been largely indigenous, we have many fewer opportunities to block procurement and to interdict shipments. And very often, our knowledge of the North Korean procurement system is quite weak because many of it takes place in China, and we have limited ability to gain information about that. In contrast, our ability to block external nuclear assistance to Iran, both in terms of official nuclear cooperation and in terms of black market procurement, has been very efficient, especially because Iran, early in the program, and still, they do a lot of shopping in Europe, where obviously we're in a very strong position, not only to learn about what they're doing, but also to work with our European allies to block those shipments. And at different points, we've been able to limit or completely cut off nuclear assistance to Iran from countries like Russia, China, India, and many others. So that slowed the program down, since the Iranians need to have external assistance. A third area of difference is that of economic sanctions. And obviously, Iran's economy, which is heavily dependent on oil exports and access to the international financial system, is much more vulnerable to economic sanctions than North Korea's impoverished and isolated economy. Furthermore, because the Iranian government is much more sensitive to pressure from public discontent with the hardships caused by economic sanctions, that's been a much more effective tool for us, as we've seen in the recent election of President Rouhani. And so we've been able to use economic sanctions currently against Iran to pressure them to freeze key aspects of their nuclear program and to engage in negotiations. A fourth area is diplomacy. In both cases, the U.S. has tried to organize an international coalition of big powers to support our diplomatic efforts. The P5 plus one talks in the case of Iran, the six-party talks in the case of North Korea. And within those coalitions, Russia has been the key party in our efforts with Iran, and China has been the key party in our efforts with North Korea. I would say in both cases, the willingness of China and Russia to cooperate with the U.S. to support our non-proliferation policies has been limited, both because of their own bilateral relationship with the countries in question, their own national interests, and their overall relationship with the U.S. But on balance, I would say we've been more successful in getting Russia to support our efforts against Iran than convincing Beijing to support our efforts against Pyongyang. And that's really because China has a much stronger geostrategic interest in the survival of North Korea and much greater sensitivity to any instability or conflict on their border. In other words, the Chinese have much more at stake than the Russians do, and I think that's led our diplomacy with Iran to be more effective in terms of mobilizing international coalitions. And finally, the military option. Our ability to threaten or use military force against North Korea has always been restricted by the fear or by the risk of causing a general conflict on the peninsula, and in particular, given the vulnerability of Seoul to artillery and rocket attack from the DMZ, it's made the military option, in my view, almost unusable, except in a very extreme circumstances. In contrast, we have a much more credible military option against Iran, because we can destroy their nuclear facilities, we have much better knowledge of where they're located, and we have much stronger ability to counter any Iranian response, given our conventional military superiority in the Persian Gulf and the broader region. And if you think about the regional players, Israel has a much more credible option to attack Iran than South Korea does to attack North Korea, just given the potential vulnerability to counterattack. And I believe that the implicit threat of force in the case of Iran has been effective in blocking and slowing Iran's nuclear program. For example, after the U.S. invasion of Afghanistan and Iraq in 2003, Tehran agreed to halt its weaponization program, it accepted more international inspectors, and at least for a time, it froze some of its key nuclear activities. Although it reversed all these restraints in 2005 after it calculated that the U.S. military threat had faded. So all of these differences that I've talked about in motivation and capability have affected the tools that the U.S. has available, and in turn, that's affected the outcome. In the case of North Korea, with three nuclear tests and a very robust set of facilities for producing fissile material, North Korea's obviously already acquired a nuclear weapons arsenal, although we don't know much about the size and its deliverability. In contrast, I would say Iran's nuclear capabilities are much more limited, and its options to produce nuclear weapons in the near term are much more constrained. So let me conclude with some thoughts about the future, and then I'd be very happy to take questions and respond to your comments. So on North Korea, well, you won't be surprised, I see very little prospect for disarming North Korea, at least as long as the Kim dynasty survives. And unfortunately, there's very little evidence that the regime is in danger of collapse. The North Koreans have demonstrated over and over again that diplomacy is not an effective tool because they've cheated or reneged on every nuclear agreement they've reached with us, including most recently the February 2012 Leap Day agreement. And having been burned several times, the Obama administration has very little appetite for resuming negotiations with North Korea. And we're currently demanding conditions from the North Koreans that I think they're very unlikely to meet as a basis for resuming talks. Instead, we're pursuing a policy that's called strategic patience, which mainly means trying to focus on economic and political pressure on Pyongyang. But I think that's very unlikely to be effective, both because North Korea is relatively impervious to economic sanctions and because China continues to protect North Korea from the worst pressure. And obviously, we don't have an attractive military option. So at this point, I think the best we can probably do is limit and delay North Korea's nuclear and missile capabilities, and in particular, try to delay the next round of nuclear and missile tests. Because without missile tests in particular, the North Koreans don't have a credible threat against the United States. Now, currently, Washington is counting on Japanese and South Korean overtures to North Korea and the threat of Chinese support for additional sanctions in order to deter Kim Jong-un from carrying out any further tests. And this may work for the next couple of years, but I doubt it will work indefinitely. So I would expect at some point in the future the North Koreans will carry out additional tests. And in the meantime, I think our best response is to strengthen defensive cooperation with Japan and Korea, and in particular to improve both homeland and regional missile defense capabilities. And strengthening defense ties with Seoul and Tokyo is also probably the best policy for reducing pressures in those countries to reverse their nuclear policies. And obviously, we have an interest in stopping even our friends from developing nuclear weapons, because that would change the balance of power in East Asia and create potential sources of conflict. So on Iran, I'm relatively more optimistic, at least in the near term. As you all know, the P5+1 nuclear talks with Iran are facing a deadline at the end of November. I doubt an agreement can be reached because the Supreme Leader Khamenei does not seem willing to accept the kind of constraints that we're demanding on Iran's enrichment program in terms of the number and type of centrifuges and the length of time that these limits would be in place. Nonetheless, I think Tehran has already signaled it would like to see an extension of the status quo, mainly because they're getting a respite from additional sanctions, and that's allowed them to stabilize their economy without having to give up their nuclear program. And the U.S. and the other P5+1 will probably favor an extension, because we've achieved a freeze on the key elements of Iran's nuclear program, thereby slowing down their move toward the production of fissile material without having to sacrifice the overall sanctions regime, which has continued to be effective. So my guess at this point is there'll be an extension of some kind at the end of November, maybe just a short extension until the end of January, which was the original one-year time frame of the Joint Plan of Action. But I wouldn't be surprised if it gets extended after that as well. Now, at best, an extension is just buying time, but buying time is probably the best we can do at this point through diplomacy. The longer term with Iran is obviously much harder to predict. I'm convinced that the current leadership, and especially Supreme Leader Khamenei, is not going to abandon his desire for nuclear weapons. This is something he's pursued for more than 20 years, and I think it's deeply embedded in his worldview. And he'll continue to look for opportunities to creep forward, to creep toward that objective. But I also think we continue to have policy tools that can delay and limit Iran's options. Ultimately, a new government may emerge in Iran that has different priorities and might be willing to accept long-term limits on the nuclear program. If not, we will ultimately have to face the choice that we've been trying to avoid, which is either to bomb Iran or to accept Iran with a bomb. But I don't think that's a choice that we face in the near term, certainly not for the rest of President Obama's presidency. So I'd like to stop there, and I'd be very happy to take your questions and listen to your comments. Obviously, anything you want to ask on Iran and North Korea, if you want to ask about broader issues of arms control and nuclear security, I'm happy to talk about that as well. Thank you.
Let me begin with the sponsor's prerogative here and ask the first question. Do you think North Korea was ever willing to give up its nuclear program, or was that a goal that was never really possible?
I was always skeptical that the agreement that I was part of, the 1994 agreed framework, I was always skeptical that the North Koreans would agree to give up their nuclear weapons. And if you, I don't know if anybody studied that, but the way that agreement was structured is that the North Koreans agreed to freeze their production of plutonium under IAEA inspection. We agreed with the Japanese and Koreans to begin a nuclear power project inside North Korea. And at a certain point in the construction of the project, it was going to halt, and the North Koreans would have to satisfy the IAEA about what we suspected was undeclared stocks of plutonium, a small amount. The CIA said enough for one or two nuclear weapons, so, you know, 8 to 10 kilograms of plutonium. And then only when the North Koreans had satisfied the IAEA would this power project resume. So this was, I mean, basically the agreed framework was structured to cap the amount of plutonium that they had, and therefore to limit the size of their nuclear arsenal over some period of years, and then at some point to give them a choice, you know, whether to declare all of that material and put it under inspection or to lose the benefit of this light water reactor program. Well, we never reached that magic point where they had to make that choice, because in the meantime, the North Koreans acquired centrifuge technology from Pakistan at some point in the mid-1990s. So not too long after the agreement was finished, the North Koreans had an opportunity from Pakistan to acquire centrifuges and centrifuge technology. And so in the even at the end of the Clinton administration in 2000, we were beginning to see some procurement activity that indicated a small-scale enrichment program. And then in the early 2000s, well, 2003, the Bush administration saw much larger procurement activity and concluded that North Korea was, you know, pursuing an extensive secret enrichment program and accused the North Koreans of cheating, which they were. And that led to a collapse of the agreed framework. So, my experience with North Korea is that they, you know, as I said, they've cheated and reneged on every agreement they've ever reached. So my conclusion is that they're not willing to give up their nuclear weapons. And I don't think we're in a position to bring enough pressure to bear on them to face the choice between survival of the regime and giving up their nuclear arsenal, because the Chinese are not prepared to put the North Koreans to the test, to put them to the place where they'd have to make that choice.
Thank you. Any other questions?
Yeah, some, yes, sir.
Yes, thanks for a great presentation. Two questions. One, can you discuss the impact of the Ukraine crisis?
Sure.
Clearly, that seems to have changed the dynamic.
Right.
I mean, you said Russia has been quite helpful in
yes.
the past, but that changed. By the way, I was just at a track 1.5 and heard a Russian North Korea specialist explain that there is a new kind of renaissance in Russian North Korean relations, which is a little disturbing. But my second question was, can you kind of unpack the Chinese approach on North Korea? You know, what is your perspective? Clearly, there's a China, you know, as I'm a China watcher, and we've seen a very, let's say, spry debate unfold in Beijing.
Right.
Among specialists there. How do you read that?
Sure. So, you know, first on Ukraine, I mean, in the P5 plus one talks, the Russians have continued to be supportive of the, you know, position that we're taking in terms of demanding very strict constraints on Iran's enrichment program, even though we know that the Russians would settle for much less. I mean, the Russians, you know, frankly don't have the same kind of demands we do in terms of limiting Iran's nuclear program. But so far, the Russians have continued to support the joint position. But at the same time, I do think the Ukraine crisis has very severely weakened our bargaining position, because the Supreme Leader, Khamenei, believes that the P5 plus one are divided and distracted. And the fact that we're sanctioning Russia at the same time that we're sanctioning Iran leads him to believe that if the talks break down, you know, the Russians may break ranks with the U.S. And in fact, the Russians and the Iranians have negotiated this oil for goods deal, which isn't in place yet, but I think it sends a signal to Washington and to Tehran that if the negotiations end, you know, the Iranians would have some option to escape some of the new sanctions that we would try to impose on them. So I think I think the Ukraine crisis has weakened our bargaining position, at least in the eyes of the Iranians, which is all that counts, and therefore makes it less likely that Khamenei would agree to the kinds of demands we're making. And that's one of the reasons why I think we're not likely to come to a deal, and why I think the talks will be extended. Because from Russia's standpoint, the status quo is very desirable. The Russians actually don't want an agreement on the nuclear issue, because that would both lead to greater Iranian oil exports, which of course would hurt Russia directly, but also lead to better relations between the U.S. and Iran. And Russia's always been nervous that we will replace Russia as the primary energy and arms partner to Russia. At the same time, the Russians don't want the talks to break down, because that would lead to more sanctions and greater risk of military conflict. So Russia, of all the P5 plus one, they're happiest with the status quo. And I think that the Russians will be pushing very hard behind the scenes to extend the current arrangements. Now, on China and North Korea, I mean, I think, you know, the Chinese are genuinely conflicted. On one hand, they don't trust the North Koreans. The Chinese leadership clearly doesn't like Kim Jong-un, who they kind of mock as the young general, and, you know, he's acted in a way that they consider to be quite irresponsible and not following China's big brotherly advice about how to behave. And I think the Chinese recognize that the more North Korea pushes its nuclear and missile program, the more it creates opportunities for the U.S. to strengthen its political and military position in East Asia. For example, providing a justification for missile defense, which the Chinese don't like. So, you know, on one hand, the Chinese would certainly favor a deal that would limit or disarm North Korea. On the other hand, the Chinese have a much bigger geostrategic concern, which is that pressure on North Korea could lead to instability and conflict. And the last thing the Chinese want is to have the Korean War start again, because of the instability that would create in the region. And ultimately, if the U.S. and our allies won that war, it would take away what the Chinese see as a bargaining chip. I mean, the traditional Chinese view of North Korea is that it ties down U.S. forces and distracts the U.S. on the Korean Peninsula, and therefore weakens our ability to defend Taiwan if there was a war over Taiwan. And I think that traditional view is still the dominant view in Beijing, but you're right, there's a younger generation of Chinese analysts and maybe officials who argue that this crazy North Korean regime, it's no longer in our interest to be protecting them, and we'd be much better off if we tried to have closer ties with Korea. And the Chinese have certainly tried to improve relations with Korea at a time, especially when Seoul and Tokyo are having very serious tensions over history issues. So I would say up to now, despite the tension in Chinese policy and despite some indications that a younger generation of Chinese experts may wish to shift strategy, I still think the dominant Chinese view is a very conservative view of protecting North Korea. And I think in particular the North Koreans have been very effective in scaring the Chinese. I mean, the Chinese are genuinely worried that if there's too much pressure on North Korea, they'll do something crazy. They'll, launch artillery attacks against South Korean positions like they did with the Waipido Islands, or they'll, be some limited excursion over the DMZ, but they'll do something that could trigger a conflict on the Korean Peninsula. And I think the Chinese, their top priority is to maintain stability and peace on the Korean Peninsula. And so therefore, they're not enthusiastic about pressuring North Korea. Yes, sir.
From a non-proliferation standpoint of North Korea's technology, some countries have benefited from that. How would you assess the effectiveness of the UN and the international community in enforcing existing sanctions, or should they be even strengthened?
Yeah. Well, it's a very good question. It's hard to answer in the abstract, because I think you have to look at, very particular cases. The irony here is that I would say this is the U.S. and the U.N. system and our allies, I think we've been quite effective overall in terms of limiting transfers of nuclear materials, equipment, and technology that have, weapons uses. Except for one big exception. And that big exception was the decision by the Pakistani government to sell enrichment and nuclear weapons technology to both Iran and North Korea. And, unfortunately, that big exception, even though we were, 99% successful, that one failure, because we just didn't know about it at the time that it took place, that one big failure has really, in a way, created the problem that we face now. Because the enrichment program in both Iran and North Korea is completely a product of Pakistani technology. I mean, it's based entirely on the technology that Pakistan transferred starting in the mid-1980s in the case of Iran, and then in the mid-90s in the case of North Korea. So I think it's one of the sort of the ironies of the whole export control system is that if you can be, very, very effective in most of what you do, but if there's one big failure, then that can undercut the whole system. And I think as a general matter, export controls, they're really more a tool of delay than being able to solve the problem. Because sooner or later, if countries are, really committed and they have reasonable resources and a reasonable scientific and industrial base, they're going to be able to master that technology themselves. And certainly that's largely the case in Iran now, and certainly true in the case of North Korea. So, the effectiveness of export controls fades over time. Yes, sir.
Two questions. You mentioned, I think, that Khamenei is pretty much on balance in favor of developing nuclear weapons, but just not in a rush. But I think I've read that he has said that he has declared that they're un-Islamic.
Right.
And I wonder if you think that it isn't maybe the IRGC, the Red Guard, that's pushing harder for it. So that was one
right.
thing. Another one is we spend an awful lot of time worrying about Iran proliferating nuclear weapons.
Yeah.
But they've got a neighbor who's got several hundred of them and a track record of proliferating, and a particularly nasty bunch, at least in the ISS from some point
right.
of view. Seems like they should be getting
yeah.
at least as much attention because they're a proven proliferator. And,
right.
If you read up on some of that, it's
right.
probably the most frightening place going.
Yes, I agree.
On that.
Sure.
The last one, if I could, piggyback on the...
No, that's fine.
If Iran were to develop a more capable conventional military, would that take their pressure off developing a nuclear weapon? So if they felt that they weren't at risk of regime change
in
a conventional military, would they still require nukes?
Right. So those are all great questions. My interpretation of Khamenei's motives is obviously my interpretation, right? I can't prove it. But I've studied him a long time, and I think I understand his worldview, which is that he deeply believes that the U.S. is the great Satan and is determined to destroy the Islamic Republic, and he interprets everything we do from that standpoint. And therefore, I believe he thinks that having nuclear weapons is a good way to deter the United States from threatening the survival of the regime. Although, as I said, I think he's cautious and careful in pursuing nuclear weapons because he certainly doesn't want to provoke a war with the U.S. He understands Iran would lose that, and that could threaten the survival of the Islamic Republic. I've always been skeptical that the fatwa is anything more than just a political gesture. You know, for one thing, nobody's ever produced the fatwa. I mean, the Iranian officials claim there is such a fatwa, but as far as I know, there's never been anything in writing. And in any event, these fatwas can be easily changed. I've heard some people say the fatwa is possession of nuclear weapons is not Islamic. I've heard other people say use of nuclear weapons is un-Islamic. So it's a little unclear exactly what it all means. I think, the U.S. government has seen the fatwa as potentially a useful diplomatic device if the Iranians want to claim that as a reason for accepting limits on their enrichment program. But that really hasn't worked because, the Iranians claim their enrichment program is purely for peaceful purposes and that they have to have a massive program to produce fuel for their nuclear power program. So, to the extent that we had hoped that the fatwa might provide a diplomatic opening for the Iranian leadership to explain to the public why they've accepted limits, that really hasn't worked out for us. On Pakistan, look, I agree that Pakistan is very, very worrisome, both in terms of nuclear security because of the potential threat to their own arsenal, and in terms of nuclear war, because you could imagine a conventional conflict between India and Pakistan escalating to a nuclear conflict, and in terms of nuclear proliferation, given, as I said earlier, the government of Pakistan is really responsible for the threat we face now from both Iran and North Korea. I think the extent to which we can do much about it is very, very limited. I mean, I'm happy to go into more detail. We have, starting in the Bush administration and continued by Obama, we have worked directly with the Pakistanis on nuclear security, protection of their nuclear weapons and facilities. And I think the Pakistanis see that there's a risk, and they've devoted a fair amount of resources to making sure that they can protect and control their nuclear weapons, because that's in their interests. So I'm not that concerned about the Pakistani Taliban attacking a nuclear base and seizing nuclear weapons. I think that's pretty unlikely. I'm much more concerned about the insider threat from within the Pakistani military, and it's very hard for the U.S. to help Pakistan deal with that problem. But I do think they're trying. Pakistan has sort of a personal reliability program, and I know of a couple of cases where people have been transferred out of sensitive positions because they were considered to be unreliable. So Pakistan's making an effort, but if something happens, we probably won't know about it until after the fact. In terms of nuclear proliferation, I think certainly the embarrassment of the revelations that took place about AQ Khan led President Musharraf to make some changes, and he certainly put AQ Khan out of business and supposedly strengthened Pakistan's export controls. The big question is whether at some point in the future Islamabad, might reverse that policy. And everybody, obviously, top of the list of concerns is whether Pakistan would transfer nuclear weapons or nuclear material to Saudi. And certainly the Saudis talk as though they believe they have a understanding with Pakistan, should they ask. Personally, I've been a bit skeptical that Pakistan would deliver on that commitment if there is such a promise. because it couldn't be hidden. I think it would, you know, be discovered quite quickly, and it would, you know, jeopardize Pakistan's access to international finance and other things. It'd be a risky thing to do. I think it's much more likely that Pakistan would offer to send its own troops to Saudi, and those troops would control nuclear weapons, just like we have nuclear weapons, you know, in Europe under NATO. And that way, the Pakistanis, would be hard for us to criticize the Pakistanis, since we do the same thing with our allies, and Pakistan would continue to have control over the nuclear weapons. I'm actually more concerned about North Korea transferring nuclear material or nuclear, you know, technology, as we know they did in the case of Syria. I mean, they were building a full production reactor in Syria before the Israelis destroyed it in 2007. And I worry in the future, if other countries in the Middle East decide they need to pursue a secret nuclear weapons program because of Iran, I think they're much more likely to turn to Pyongyang than to turn to Islamabad, and I worry that North Korea will be willing, as they have in the past, to sell nuclear technology. And, you know, again, that's another, the Syrian reactor is another very good example of how poor our intelligence has been. I mean, that reactor was fairly close to operation before the Israelis told us about it, and I understand from my Israeli friends, they discovered it almost by accident. So, you know, I mean, think what the Syrian situation would look like now in the middle of the civil war if they'd been able to operate that reactor for a couple of years and produce enough plutonium for a few nuclear weapons. So I really think that North Korea is a bigger threat of right now, but we obviously need to keep our eyes on Pakistan.
Thank you.
Yes?
I'm from the Department of State, and I think in the past I've been assigned to holding doors open for you at the U.S. It's a real privilege to have you.
Oh, yeah, it's nice to see you again.
My question is just, you started talking about Israel. Would you talk a little bit more about
sure.
Israel's role in the region? I mean, I'm just interested from a diplomatic perspective.
Sure.
Of course, huge allies, but also extremely difficult to work with.
Right.
And just wondering if you could talk more about that.
Sure. I'm happy to do that. So I think that, in my experience in the White House this last time around, it was a very sharp contrast between the working relationship between the governments, and by that I mean the military and the diplomats and the intelligence people and the officers. I mean, that was extraordinarily close at the working level on the Iran, you know, nuclear threat, which included, you know, sharing intelligence and assessments and, you know, operations in a way that's quite extraordinary, and coordinating diplomacy and export controls and so forth. That worked very, very well. But at the top, obviously, the personal relationship between President Obama and Prime Minister Netanyahu was not close. And there was not, very much trust, or affection there. And that particularly became an issue because I think at around 2012, Israel, Prime Minister Netanyahu, and Defense Minister Mr. Barak wanted to some kind of U.S. acquiescence to attack Iran, and they tried very hard to get the U.S. to be prepared to give them a yellow light, or at least, you know, accept that they could do it if they wanted to. And the U.S. pushed back very, very hard, arguing that we didn't think that it was necessary because we thought we still had time, and that it would be counterproductive because it would likely lead the Iranians not only to launch some counterattack, which could affect Israel and Saudi and other countries, but also could lead the Iranians to leave the non-proliferation treaty, and therefore they would be able to pursue their nuclear program without any international inspection and without any legal limits on what they could do. And of course, you know, at the end of the day, the Israelis accepted, I think grudgingly accepted, that you know, they really couldn't carry out an attack without some kind of support or at least acquiescence from the U.S. So in terms of the broader sort of Israeli role, I mean, obviously from our standpoint, our position in the region would be much easier to coordinate between Israel and the moderate Arab countries who have a lot of common interests, including both are opposed to Iran, both are opposed to ISIS. If we could solve the Palestinian issue, but I'm afraid that, I mean, you know how pessimistic I am about some of these, about these proliferation issues. I'm even more pessimistic about solving the Palestinian issue. So I think that's sort of a handicap that is just baked into U.S. policy in the Middle East. And it's going to be a point of friction, not only with Israel, but with the Arab countries as well, because both of them think we're not doing enough. So, you know, the Arabs get angry at us because we're not doing more to stop Israel from, you know, putting settlements in place in, you know, in the occupied territories, and the Israelis are angry at us for, you know, not doing more to oppose what the Palestinians are doing at the UN or whatever. And I don't know any way to solve that. I just think that's one of the sort of elements of U.S. policy that we've had to deal with, you know, since the establishment of Israel in 1948. But I think that that tension in the relationship between a good working relationship at the government level and tension at the top, I mean, that's very personal, and so I don't think it's, you know, likely to continue after President Obama's term in office.
And will Israel just not allow a nuclearized Iran?
I, you know, I think the Israelis are serious about using military force if they, you know, feel that Iran is making a direct effort to acquire nuclear weapons. But for that matter, I think the U.S. would use military force if the Iranians in an open way were moving to produce nuclear weapons, for example, by producing highly enriched uranium. But I think for that reason, the Iranians are not likely to do it. I mean, you know, as I look at Iranian behavior, it's always been very calculated and cautious. They make judgments about what do we think we can get away with now, without provoking a military attack or more sanctions. And I think, I mean, I'm, you know, projecting here, but I believe that the Supreme Leader understands that the production of weapons-grade uranium could be a casus belli. And therefore, I think it's very unlikely that he would do it at the declared facilities. I think much more likely is that Iran will try once again to build a secret enrichment plant so they could do it without anybody detecting it. And so far, we've been very good at detecting those facilities, as I said, before they're finished, and we've been able to expose them and force Iran to put them under safeguards. You know, in terms of the Israeli military option, you know, their officers are very confident that they could carry out an attack that would at least damage the program enough to set it back for a few years. But they recognize that the U.S. military option is much more credible and effective. I mean, just given our forces in the Persian Gulf. So from Israel's standpoint, they would much prefer that if anybody carries out an attack, it's the U.S. and not them. Yes, sir.
Sir, fellow student here as well, great presentation. You laid out some compelling arguments about the different tools the United States has and the differences between the two nations. I would argue, though, there's some similarities between the nations in terms of how they produce or pursue their proliferation of nuclear weapons. So I guess my question is that certainly on different timelines, North Korea has been more than Iran. Iran has been learning from North Korea. Mm-hmm. It's learning today from Iran in terms of the international community's interaction, both from North Korea's perspective and now Iran. Who's the next proliferator we need to worry about?
Yeah, well, that's a really good question. I think that we're fortunate in that in almost every part of the world, there's not any likely candidates. I mean, there's no pressure for proliferation in Europe, in Africa, in Latin America, Southeast Asia. There's no country there that is a potential candidate. I thought Burma was at least a possibility, but I think with the change in orientation in their foreign policy and our effort to lift sanctions, and of course they've accepted the additional protocol from the IAEA, I think that's probably not a worry, even if it, I'm not even sure it was serious to begin with. But anyway, that I think. So to me, the only regions of the world where there's a significant threat is East Asia and the Middle East. Now in East Asia, you have countries like Japan and Korea, or Taiwan for that matter, which have tremendous technical capacity. I mean, obviously they could produce nuclear weapons very quickly. especially Japan, because it has such a large stockpile of fissile material. But the constraint, the political constraints, I think, are pretty significant. There are both domestic constraints, especially in the case of Japan, but there are constraints because of the alliance system. And I do think that, I mean, in the past, and I'm going back to the 60s and 70s and 80s, the U.S. has been very effective in persuading Taipei and Tokyo and Seoul, you know, to give up any consideration of nuclear weapons because of the strength of the alliance system. And I think if we continue to maintain a strong position in Asia, those political constraints will continue to be powerful, even though, you know, both Chinese modernization of their nuclear weapons and expansion of North Korea's nuclear weapons does create pressure. And so, well, Terry's an expert in this. You certainly see some subtle shifts in both sort of expert opinion and public opinion in Seoul and Tokyo that's moving in the direction of more acceptance or more support for developing nuclear weapons. But I don't see it, at least in the, you know, in the foreseeable future, as likely to become overwhelming. And I think we still have ways to tamp it down. I don't know if you agree with that.
I think that's right. I mean, you see some corners, particularly in South Korea, talking about
right.
a nuclear option, but I'm very skeptical that they would actually
yeah.
go in that direction at this point, unless there was a severe change in the security environment or to the alliance, that there was somehow some
that's right.
tremendous weakening of the U.S.-South Korean alliance. Otherwise, I think that's fairly solid.
Yeah. I'm much more concerned. I mean, if anybody goes nuclear in East Asia, I think South Korea is much more likely than Japan, because there aren't the same domestic constraints in South Korea. In fact, there's been some public polls where a majority of
sure.
Koreans have said, yes, we should have nuclear weapons. The North has nuclear weapons. They threaten us. Why shouldn't we have nuclear weapons? But the Japanese, because of World War II, there's still a very strong nuclear allergy. And so therefore, I think Korea is a you know, greater risk. You know, in the Middle East, you have the opposite situation. You have countries that have very little political constraint. I mean, none of the countries, setting aside Israel, which already has nuclear weapons, but none of the other countries really feel that they have anything like the same kind of security relationship. I mean, they don't trust us to protect them, frankly. And so therefore, they're not really, and I mean, just in terms of domestic opinion, when I talk to your average Egyptian or Saudi or even Turk, they all say, of course we should have nuclear weapons. The Israelis have nuclear weapons. The Persians have nuclear weapons. Why shouldn't the Arabs have nuclear weapons? So there's no domestic constraint in terms of politics, but there are very significant technical constraints. I mean, none of those countries have anything like, you know, the kind of industrial or scientific base that would be necessary to indigenously produce nuclear weapons in any reasonable time frame. I mean, decades, even Turkey, which is the most advanced, would take decades. So the only shortcut they have is very substantial external assistance. And as we were talking about, we have to watch both North Korea and Pakistan as a potential threat. So I think that you know, if the next country that produces nuclear weapons is likely to be either in East Asia or in the Middle East, but I don't see any imminent risk. I think we have time to try to work on it and slow it down and potentially prevent it. Anybody else want to ask about something other than Iran and North Korea?
Well, let me ask an Iran question. Do you think Iran would be willing to go up to some certain line and stop with some sort of existential capability,
right.
but not go beyond
right.
to test
yeah.
or something of
yeah.
those lines?
Well, this is what... I mean, this is what the Iranian moderates say. They say that, you know, we live in a very dangerous neighborhood. We have countries that are armed with nuclear weapons all around us, including, you know, India, Pakistan, Israel, Russia, the U.S. So we need to have some kind of an option. And therefore, we need to have an industrial-scale enrichment program. So that in extremis, we would have the ability to produce nuclear weapons and defend ourselves. But they say, don't worry, we're too smart to want to actually build nuclear weapons, because we know that could lead to a war and it would antagonize the neighbors. So you, I mean, what the moderate you know, Iranians say privately is, you can trust us to be like Japan. You can entrust us to have, you know, facilities to produce fissile material, but we won't actually go nuclear. I don't believe that, because I think in the Middle East, which is a very, you know, militarized part of the world, where you have, you know, constant conflict and violence and buildup of military capabilities, having a latent capacity is not worth very much. I mean, if the Iranians really think they have to deter their enemies and defend themselves against threats, having a breakout ability, which is months away, is not the same as having nuclear warheads on top of missiles, which can be fired immediately. And this goes to the question that you asked about conventional. I don't think the Iranians see conventional as a substitute for nuclear. I think they see, I mean, those that favor nuclear weapons, see nuclear weapons, you know, in their own right as a powerful deterrent. I don't think the Iranians want nuclear weapons to actually use them against somebody, but because they see it as, you know, as a deterrent. And, you know, the, I mean, it's unfortunate, but it's true that if you look at, you know, the last 20 years, I mean, the U.S. has been pretty willing, when necessary, to attack and invade countries that don't have nuclear weapons. But we haven't attacked and invaded any countries that have nuclear weapons. So if you can, I mean, so anybody studying that would, I think, come to the conclusion that we're deterred by the presence of nuclear weapons. We are.
Gary, you touched a little bit on China and,
sure,
and Chinese nuclear modernization.
Right.
A lot of folks in this room and in this place are always very interested in China.
Sure.
I'm wondering if you could say a few words about that.
Yeah. So let me say a couple things. As I'm, as I'm sure you all know from studying the issue, China has been engaged in a modernization program that goes back at least a couple of decades, basically to move away from the fixed silos to road mobile, ICBMs, and a class of nuclear submarines. And I think that's not very surprising. In fact, I'm surprised how long China was willing to tolerate a situation where its strategic nuclear forces were so vulnerable. Because, as you know, they had a very small number of, you know, liquid-fueled ICBMs and fixed silos with the warheads not, you know, deployed. They were very, very, I mean, in sort of your classic, you know, strategic theory, they were very vulnerable to a preemptive strike from the United States. And so I'm not surprised that they've moved in the direction of having forces that they will consider to be, you know, much more secure. And that they'd be able to withstand a first strike and still have enough forces left over to inflict very serious damage on the U.S. And I think the Chinese, unlike the Russians, I think the Chinese, when they do their calculation of how much is enough, I don't think they think in terms of war fighting. The Russians, you know, are still stuck in the old Cold War calculation of whether they will have residual forces that can attack U.S. nuclear targets and strategic targets. The Chinese have a much simpler calculation, which is, basically, that a minimum deterrence. If they can destroy some, you know, reasonable number of American cities, that should be sufficient to deter the United States from attacking their nuclear assets, which I think is an accurate calculation. And so I don't see the Chinese, at least, you know, for the foreseeable future, I don't see them being interested in making a bid for parity. I mean, if we reduced our forces unilaterally or with the Russians to the point where they were comparable with the Chinese, so they'd be happy to accept it. But I don't think that's their objective. I think their objective is to have a reasonably secure second strike capability. With forces that would be, there would be enough forces left over to destroy some number of U.S. cities. And in some ways, that's stabilizing, right? Because it removes any temptation we would have to launch a first strike. But I also think that you can't look at the nuclear buildup without looking at the broader conventional. To me, the conventional modernization that the Chinese are doing in terms of, you know, area access denial is much more worrisome to us than their nuclear buildup, because that they're clearly, not in the near term, but in the long term, trying to create a capability that would make it impossible for us to project power close to the shore. I don't worry. There's a big debate, I'm sure you know, there's a big debate in academia about, you know, is war between the U.S. and China inevitable? And people look at historical examples of rising powers and status quo powers and so forth. And obviously there's no question that China's a rising power and we're a status quo power in Asia. But my sense from talking to the Chinese is that they recognize that, again, for the foreseeable future, that the military balance is still heavily against them. Because it's not just the U.S., it's the U.S. and all its allies in Asia, including the Japanese, which in many ways have a more capable Navy and, you know, Air Force than the Chinese do. So I think the Chinese will be very careful in terms of doing things that they worry may, you know, lead to conflict. And if incidents take place, as there have been, I think they'll look for ways to de-escalate rather than to, escalate. Instead, I think the Chinese see their economic power as a much more effective tool to weaken U.S. influence in Asia and to strengthen their position. And I think for the time being, I think they'll focus much more on investment and trade as a way to strengthen Chinese position. Now, they'll still modernize, of course, their military. But I'd be interested in your views, but I think the likelihood of a, you know, big war between the U.S. and China over the next decade, I think, is very small. But obviously, just to add, obviously we need to keep, I mean, as long as the Chinese believe that a war would be disastrous, that they would lose a war, I think they're not likely to seek one. And obviously we need to continue to maintain a military balance so they believe that. Yes?
Sir, I'd like to get your opinion on the priority within the U.S. government concerning, you know, nuclear weapons or any weapons of mass destruction as far
right.
as the likelihood of their use. The reason why I say that is, like, General Colin Powell on the media just recently came on TV and goes, I am convinced that nuclear weapons are useless.
Right.
And we spend a significant amount yeah. of defense dollars in either improving our DQRs or being prepared
right.
for their use. So what is the general feeling within
sure.
your Washington concerning
sure.
this possible threat, you know,
yeah.
and what is the likelihood of your life being?
Right. So, I mean, obviously, during the Cold War, the dominant security threat we thought we faced was an existential one, that if there was a nuclear war between the U.S. and the Soviet Union, it would destroy us. So with the end of the Cold War, I think that fear or worry has reduced, and we're much more focused on these, you know, smaller, I mean, the nuclear threat has shifted to a focus on either non-state actors, like Al-Qaeda acquiring nuclear weapons, or on these much smaller countries that could pose a potential threat first to our allies and then to us, like Iran and North Korea. So to me, the centrality of nuclear weapons to U.S. strategy and military policy is, you know, clearly reduced. And as a consequence, we've drawn down our nuclear forces. But nuclear weapons are still good for one thing, which is they're very good for deterrence. And to the extent that the big powers, I mean, the U.S. and Russia and China, still are in a situation where even the possibility of a major conflict and the use of nuclear weapons is still not considered unthinkable, then we're going to continue to maintain nuclear forces, which means they have to be effective and credible. And I don't see any near-term likelihood that the relationship between the U.S. and Russia and the U.S. and China could change to the point where we would be so comfortable politically that we would just discount the possibility, even though the possibility is incredibly small, right? I don't stay up at night worrying about nuclear war between the U.S. and Russia or the U.S. and China. But they still have, you know, forces that potentially could threaten the United States, and they feel that we have forces that potentially threaten them. So I think, unfortunately, we're going to continue to invest in keeping a very robust nuclear capability. And that doesn't mean huge investment in the next couple of years, although some of the costs for the life extension programs like for the B-61 bomb, are quite expensive. But the big bucks will, of course, be down the road when we have to, you know, deploy new delivery systems, especially the submarines. Bombers and ICBMs less so. And I, you know, it's hard to predict at this point whether, I think there's room for at least one more round of nuclear reductions with the Russians. And of course, Obama's already said he'd be willing to come down one third from the New START numbers. So that would be a reduction from 1550, you know, a 1550 deployed strategic warheads to about 1,000. The Russians aren't willing to do that because of their concerns about missile defense. But they, at least on paper, they also have an interest in having somewhat smaller forces, if only to save money, because they're spending an awful lot on their nuclear modernization. So it's possible in the next decade we could have another round of reductions with the Russians, and that would reduce somewhat our expenses. But I think overall, I think we're condemned for the foreseeable future to maintain a, you know, pretty substantial nuclear force. I mean, even 1,000 nuclear weapons is, you know, much more than anybody else has, including the Chinese. Yes, sir.
Just to follow on the back of what you were just saying, that President Obama has set the goal of zero.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, you said you were pessimistic about
right.
the ability to counter proliferate. In fact, probably yeah. trends going the other way. How do you or the president square that? And
yeah.
how do you get that last step down to zero, that the
right.
most difficult step possible?
Yeah. Well, of course, I can't speak for the president. But for me, I always saw the zero as a distant goal, as an aspiration. And of course, that's been a common element of U.S. policy. I mean, going back to Kennedy and Reagan have all espoused the ultimate objective of nuclear disarmament. But as a realistic matter, I don't think it could possibly take place in the foreseeable future. And in fact, the sad thing is that, as you say, the trend has been in the opposite direction. I mean, in Europe, the nuclear powers are basically just maintaining the status quo. So the UK and France, they're just maintaining their forces. We and the Russians have reduced very much from the Cold War, although we're modernizing delivery systems. But in Asia, there's a buildup. I mean, Pakistan, India, China, North Korea, they're all building up and modernizing their nuclear forces, and I don't think there's anything we can do to stop that. So I think, I mean, we may be able to prevent further proliferation, but in terms of the nine countries in the world that have nuclear weapons, I don't think any of them are willing to give them up, you know, anytime soon. And they will, and therefore, in order to keep them, they will keep maintaining them and modernizing them. And that's just going to be a permanent feature of, you know, of international politics. Although we should look back with some, you know, happiness in history. Certainly in the days of President Kennedy, the expectation was that there would be 20 or 30 nuclear armed powers. And if you look back, many, many countries in the 50s and 60s and 70s thought about developing nuclear weapons. I mean, even in Europe, Germany, Italy, Sweden, Switzerland, they all had internal studies, should we build nuclear weapons? And in Asia, Taiwan, Japan, Korea, I mean, lots of countries have thought about developing nuclear weapons and decided they didn't need them. So we're much better off than we thought we would be, you know, 40 years, 50 years on. But I just think nuclear abolition is not a realistic policy objective. It's an aspirational objective. Yes, sir.
Irrespective of this sort of difficulty of getting to nuclear zero, why would we want to be there anyway? Wouldn't nuclear zero be highly unstable, giving the advantage to first cheaper to produce one?
Right. Look, I think there's a lot of, you know, legitimate questions about whether what the impact of nuclear zero would be. I mean, in my view, you'll never reach nuclear zero until there's such a fundamental transformation in the international system so that not only nuclear weapons, but most weapons are no longer seen as being a, you know, legitimate instrument of national power. And, you know, this is the example I use. Suppose the only countries in the world that had nuclear weapons were the US and the UK. Could we go to zero? Of course. Because we're not worried about the UK using nuclear weapons against us.
Couldn't, because if the only countries that were US and UK, we went to zero.
Right.
And some country we didn't trust, the first country we didn't trust,
right.
Iran, that produced one,
right.
We'd be screwed.
Well, you'd have to be confident that nobody would cheat, which is hard to imagine how you could achieve that. And also, everybody has the ability to reconstitute.
But everyone has the motivation to cheat. Everybody.
Well, you know, I mean, as I say, nuclear zero is an aspirational objective.
Why is it even aspirational? It would be a disaster.
Right. Well, I think there's a good practical reason. I think, as you know, the NPT is built on this so-called bargain, where the countries that don't have nuclear weapons promise that they won't build them. They forswear building them. And the NPT's been very, very successful. And the nuclear weapon states promise to engage in a process of disarmament. So I think the keeping that general bargain alive without actually trying to achieve zero, I think it's an effective diplomatic tool. And, you know, frankly, nobody seriously thinks that nuclear disarmament. I mean, nobody in a responsible position in any government considers nuclear disarmament to be a realistic objective under current international conditions. And current international conditions, which means that countries still see military force as a legitimate instrument of state power, is going to persist for many, many centuries, my guess is. Sure.
Making a lot of noise,
or are we looking at a better retrenchment on the I'll give you my opinion, which is a little different than I think the dominant view in the media. I mean, I think Putin has acted out of fear. I think Putin had a concern, which was, I think, quite legitimate from his standpoint, that the revolution in Ukraine would shift Kiev out of the Russian orbit into a Western orbit, starting with, you know, closer economic ties, joining the EU, and ultimately joining NATO. And I think, in fact, there's a very significant portion of the Western Ukrainian population and political elite that want to be associated with the West, that their view is toward Europe. They want to be part of the EU, they want to be part of NATO to protect themselves against Russia. And I think from Putin's standpoint, that's an intolerable threat to Russian security. Not only because he's worried about the military threat of NATO moving east, but also because Putin really believes that the CIA is orchestrating these color revolutions, starting with Ukraine, and then we'll use that as the springboard to, you know, first Maidan Square, next the Red Square. So I think that from the very beginning, I was worried that we would help create a situation where Putin would feel compelled to use military force to prevent Ukraine from slipping out of Russia's grasp. And as I saw President Poroshenko, you know, pursue a military victory, I was pretty confident that at some point, I don't think Putin wanted to intervene in eastern Ukraine, but I think he just felt he had no choice when it was clear that the separatists were going to lose. So, you know, now Putin's won the war. I mean, it was very clear, you know, I think we and the Europeans looked a bit feckless that we could be accused of, to some extent, encouraging Poroshenko to, you know, be very aggressive, and then in the end we didn't do a thing, except some economic sanctions, which are probably not very effective. So I didn't think that this had turned out very well for us. And the big question is whether a political settlement is possible between Kiev and the rebels, and whether Putin is prepared to help mediate and endorse such a settlement, which would include presumably some federalism, some assurance that Ukraine would remain neutral, would not join any military blocs. There'd be protections for the Russian-speaking minority and so forth. I'm, I mean, the election certainly have strengthened Poroshenko, which is a good thing. But I'm not very confident that Putin at this point is interested in a political deal, because I think he's, you know, just given his mindset, I think he's genuinely concerned that if, that any, even if there was a political deal that neutralized, you know, Ukraine, I don't know that Putin would have much confidence that that would be permanent. From his standpoint, that might be the first step toward, you know, toward Kiev joining the EU, you know, and then joining NATO, because he doesn't trust the U.S. and the Europeans, and he sees that there's, you know, genuine sentiment in, you know, parts of Ukraine for that. So I'm afraid Putin will probably prefer to see kind of a frozen conflict-like scenario, like in Moldova, where the East remains, you know, nominally part of Ukraine, but where the real political authority is, you know, exercised by the separatists, who will be completely under Russia's control. And that way, if Kiev pushes toward closer economic or political association with the West, Putin can always start the war again. And I've heard some of my Ukrainian friends have said, well, you know, it, you know, the winter's not very good season for fighting, but wait till the spring. So I'm somewhat concerned that the war will flare up again in the spring. And as I said, I think that Russia has demonstrated that, you know, if push comes to shove, they will use military force to protect their interests in Ukraine. And the U.S. and Europe are not prepared to use military force. So to me, under those circumstances, I don't think it's a very good idea for us to try to push the envelope, because we're going to end up looking weak again, I think. Yes, sir.
How do you think U.S. missile defense affects some of these rogue actors, right, like North Korea, Iran, and then maybe even Russia and China? How do you view that?
Sure, I'm happy to do that. You know, the advocates of missile defense have always argued that missile defense will persuade countries like Iran and North Korea that there's no value in developing ballistic missiles because they can be defeated. I have to say, I've seen zero evidence of that. Absolutely zero evidence that that is persuasive. Now, I don't know why that is, whether those countries calculate that they can come up with the means to overcome missile defense through, you know, decoys and penetration aids or large numbers of missiles. But I just see no evidence that the, you know, missile defense has dampened down their interest in developing long-range missiles that can strike the United States. In the case of Russia and China, I think that, you know, our missile, I mean, there's an irony here, right? Russia has, you know, hundreds of nuclear weapons compared to China, but I think Russia is much more scared about missile defense than China is. And the reason for that is the difference in what their nuclear doctrine is. Russia, as I said, is still views the nuclear balance in terms of the Cold War kind of warfighting calculation. And the Russians, I think, are genuinely afraid that in some future scenario, when we build out missile defense, we would be able to launch a first strike and destroy the vast majority of Russian strategic forces and still have enough missile defense left over to, you know, defeat any residual, you know, capability they had. Now that's a crazy scenario, because under any reasonable, you know, calculation, the Russians would still be able to destroy, you know, a lot of American cities, and no president would do that. The Chinese, on the other hand, as I said, they have a minimal, you know, sort of a minimal deterrent policy as opposed to a warfighting policy. So they're pretty confident, I think, that they can overcome our missile defense with enough weapons so that we would never attack them in the first place. But I do think, you know, to some extent, I think missile defense is driving modernization in both Russia and China. And, you know, as a practical matter, I think that both those countries have the capacity to overcome any missile defense we can reasonably deploy. I mean, missile defense is just never going to be effective, in my view, against a big country that has a lot of resources. I do think missile defense has at least a chance of being effective against small countries like North Korea and Iran, especially in a, you know, in a preemption scenario. I mean, it's not something we want to think about, but if there was a, I mean, just imagine if there was a, you know, a new conflict on the Korean Peninsula, and we saw the North Koreans beginning to mobilize their nuclear forces, there'd be tremendous pressure on the U.S. and Japan and Korea to launch preemptive strikes. And, I mean, the big danger of that, of course, is that the North Koreans, if they saw their nuclear forces being destroyed, they might feel they had to use them in a crisis. And then the question would be whether missile defense would be effective against even a small, you know, even a minimal force. And I think that's still a challenge for missile defense. I think we're still having a lot of difficulty making it work just because it's technically so difficult, even against a primitive, you know, ICBM capability.
Drew, you get the last question.
Gary.
Hi, John.
We build on that a little in terms of the proliferation of missile defense.
Right.
And then a proliferation of counters to that, whether it's penetration aids or others, and talk a little bit about that, not in the US,
sure,
Russia-China context,
right,
but in the, you know, Japan, South Korea, North Korea, India, Pakistan.
Right.
And, you know, what drivers that may push, even if, you know, missile defense isn't perfectly effective,
right,
for countries to proliferate and share penetration aids, other counters to missile defense.
Yeah. I mean, this is very technical, but my impression is that some of the sort of first generation penetration aids are not very challenging to do, and so it may very well be, I mean, things like balloons. So it may very well be that even countries like Iran and North Korea are going to be able, if they ever have a real ICBM force, which they don't now and they're many years away from, they may feel that they can deploy that, and that may pose a big challenge for us if we're not able to overcome it. I think the sort of nuclear balance in South Asia is not likely to be very affected by missile defense. I don't know the exact status, but I know the Indians we've been encouraging the Indians to develop missile defense. But the distances there are so short, and I think the likelihood to use weapons against cities, will be so great if there's ever a nuclear conflict, that I'm skeptical that missile defense will have much of an impact. But certainly the Pakistanis have said, if the Indians deploy missile defense, we'll have to increase our nuclear force so that we can overcome it. So in that sense, I think the dynamic would be the same. But between India and China and India and Pakistan, I don't see much, at this point, impact of missile defense, because I don't think those countries are likely to really commit the resources for robust missile defense. I don't know, have you seen any?
I think it's sort of the next step. I think India, Pakistan's reacting to what India,
right,
says it will do.
Yeah.
Even if it's not necessarily,
yeah,
there, or even if it's a long way off.
Right.
It's one of a number of things that Pakistan,
yeah,
is reacting to,
right,
in terms of their perception of,
yeah,
an Indian threat, particularly combined with potentially a fear of an Indian conventional preemptive,
right,
strike.
Yes. Which I think is a real risk. I mean, I think the Pakistanis are very, very sensitive to their perceived vulnerability to a conventional strike. And of course, one of the big worries about them moving for battlefield weapons is that that'll lower the nuclear threshold even further. You know, we didn't talk about, much about India, but India is a fascinating nuclear weapons program because it's the most slow motion, disorganized, inefficient, and under-resourced nuclear weapons program of any big power. But they seem to be very comfortable with that. And I think it's because they don't see nuclear weapons as something that they need for their survival. It's more a hedge against, China and deterrence against Pakistan, and they can really afford to take their time.
Well, first I want to thank Heidi and the Middle East Studies Group, yeah, again for your help in co-sponsoring, but most importantly to Gary Samore for an excellent lecture and question. We really appreciate it.
Thank you. Thanks, everybody. Thank you.